I would like to say that I'm going to deal about, of course, modeling, but also about biology. And I am not a biologist, so I would really like to apologize to biologists if I made mistakes or if things are not completely correct. I love biology, but it's a hard matter, and I tried to learn as much as I could. So let me start. I want to give some introduction, which will maybe be a bit long, but I think it's important because maybe not all of you are familiar with the retina. And at some point, I will also deal with modeling of the retina compared to modeling of the cortex. And I think it's important to have this basis. So this is a view of the visual system. So the light enter into your eyes, and I will explain what is happening at the level of the retina. Spike trains, which go through via the optic nerve first to the thalamus, and in particular to the lateral geniculate nucleus, and then which are displayed to the visual cortex. So this is something amazing. All of us, we are seeing, and most of the time we don't think how much it is a miracle to see. And when you try to investigate a bit the mechanism, it's just puzzling. Well, for some people, for example, people who are going to be blind, and I'm going to speak briefly about them later, then you realize how much vision is a miracle. And so it's a difficult, topic, but I think we will learn more and more. So today I want to deal with this thin membrane, which is at the end of the eye, at the, which is the retina. This is a brain. It's half a millimeter thick, for human, and of order a few millimeters square. And here we see its structure. I will go deeper in this structure in 1 minute. Just it's important here to note that the optic nerve is here, and it's made by the axons of these cells, which are called ganglion cells. And so the optic nerve is the axon, the union of the axons of this cell. And I'm going to explain why, in fact, the retina is inverted compared to what you are expecting. So this is another view of the retina, which is more detailed. So the light goes here, but the cells we are capturing the photons are here. So they are at the bottom of the retina. So from an engineer perspective, the retina is inverted, and there are good reasons for that. I'm going to explain it in 1 minute. Basically, these photoreceptors are incredible cells because they are able to capture photons in the range of visible light and to convert this photon into a variation of electric potential. So in fact, there are different types of photoreceptors. There are rods which are sensitive to dim light. And actually, in some animals, these rods are able to detect one photon in the visible range. But we have also cones, which are here, which are sensitive to daily light and to color. So in humans, we have three types of cones, those which are sensitive to blue, green, and red. And the size of these cells depends on the frequencies they like to detect. For blue are small, and for red are long, and it's related to the wavelengths. So yes, so these cells are able to do something fantastic. They are able to capture one photon or several photons and to convert that into variation of potential. So now this photoreceptor needs a lot of resources, and they need a lot of nutrients, or to say food, as if you want, or energy. So that's why they need to be close to the blood vessels, which are here. Mm-hmm. So this is one of the reasons why the retina is inverted, because these cells are really eager to have blood. And one other reason is that the cells of the retina are transparent to light, which is not the case of blood vessels. So now, once these photoreceptors have captured photons, there will some cascade, very interesting cascade is happening. It's an enzymatic cascade, which in the end will result in the closing of sodium channels, which, for example, one photon is able to generate a variation of potential of about 1 millivolt. So you realize that it's a huge amplification factor, because one photon has not so much energy as you can believe. And nevertheless, thanks to this enzymatic cascade, here at the bottom of this photoreceptor, you will be able to measure variation of order 1 millivolt for one photon. So I want also to emphasize that all the processes I'm going to deal with, I mean, especially dealing with very complex image, encoding, decoding, etc., and this transition cascade, is done with a very low energy cost. Whatever you are seeing, which means this is very important for life. So this means that all these processes need to have a very low energy consumption. And for people who are trying to invent devices, electronic devices doing the same, you realize that it's a challenge because, I mean, if you switch on a camera or a computer, you take immediately several degrees. You cannot afford that in a human body. So so when this photoreceptor get photons, they get hyperpolarized, and then this means that you will release, in fact, less neurotransmitter, which is, in the case, it's glutamate. And now I will not enter into the detail, but this glutamate will connect to these bipolar cells. And actually, you have two different types of receptors. You have AMPA and NMDA, which will make the glutamate which excitatory, which means that you keep the polarity, but you have also other type of receptor which are called metabotropic, like mGlur, which are inverting the sign. So which means that when the photoreceptor get hyperpolarized, in the sign inverted, the cell here becomes excited. So I don't want to enter too much detail, but basically what you will have. You will have this whole cascade coming from the capture of light to these cells, which are the ganglion cells, and all this structure is essentially converting the information, the image, or a visual scene. Actually, it's more than image because we are dealing with motion. Or this is also something that I would like to emphasize. When we deal with the visual system, you need to realize that static image do not exist. All the time you have motion because your eyes are moving, your head is moving. So this very small structure is able to record and to process motion in very complex situation. So all this structure will convert this information about motion into spike trains, which will be transmitted via the optic nerves to the visual cortex. No, in fact, this is a summary of what we have here. Spikes are emitted here and are decoded here. So, if you think of the retina in terms of our modern vision of information theory from Neumann, Turing, and so on, it's relatively natural to think that the retina is a kind of encoder and the brain is a visual cortex is a kind of a decoder. This is fine. I would like to mention that it's a contemporary view. You can have other point of view. It's common in nowadays code. It's not absolutely clear that there is only one code in the case of the retina. And this is one interpretation. I will come back to this interpretation in 1 minute. Nevertheless, if you look at the structure of the retina, it's relatively easy to see that you have two main flow. The first one is this one, from photoreceptor to ganglion cells, where you just have a direct pathway from here to here. So basically what you will have information about local image or local visual scene, because the photoreceptor capture only part of the visual scene. So this will be transmitted to these cells. And so you can see all the axons of the ganglion cell are parallel channels sending local information about the visual scene. This is fine, but there is another structure that you can see here corresponding to these two types of cells, horizontal cells and amacrine cells, which connect flows of information, which essentially means that, strictly speaking, you cannot consider them as independent. Unless something miraculous happens, and of course, this is always possible, but in general, you have correlation between these channels. So the role of horizontal cells is very well known because they contribute to the generation of what is called the receptive field, for in particular, the center surround opposition in the receptive field that was revealed by Hubble and Wiesel. So we know very well how this horizontal cell contribute to the center surround receptive field. But amacrine cells are less known, and I would like today essentially to deal mainly about them because, biologists are progressively discovering them, but there is a lot of just want to make a short remark, which will allow me to go further in my description of the retina. So again, you can view this structure as encoder, decoder, information flux. But there is another reason why the ganglion cells are produced along the distance, which is a few centimeters or even more. And we know very well that these spikes are able to conduct the potential over long distance. Whereas if you had a classical ohmic conduction, this pulse will just drop exponentially fast after a few centimeters. So one of the main reasons why these cells are producing spikes is just to transmit information up to the visual cortex. You don't need necessarily to address the question of a neural code. Of course, there is certainly an encoding that we have to understand, but there is a physical gate, this type of variation of potential on long distance. And this is very interesting because this has a consequence for the retina. The only cells which are spiking are the ganglion cells. The other cells, because they are very close together, they essentially work in an analogic way. You have just analogic computation. You have no spike here. I just want to make a short warning when I speak about spikes, because sometimes it can be confusing. I am speaking of sodium, potassium, Hodgkin's spike, because later we will see calcium spikes. But these spikes, essentially, you don't have them in the structure of the retina, only at the end to transmit the information to the visual cortex. Now, I would like to end this biological part. I would like to make a switch to modeling, and I'm going to do a bit of biology still. So now, if you think of the decoder, the visual cortex, well, people have identified structures in this visual cortex called cortical colons, which are nicely seen when you do optical imaging. So here, each point corresponds to one pixel of optical imaging. And in fact, they are related to preferred orientation. So when you present, this is a cat, when you present a bar oriented like this, cortical colons in green activate. When you present this bar red, cortical colon activate, etc. So here you have a structure which are quite complex, because this cortical colon contains about thousands of neurons, and this is about, you see 0.11 millimeter, depending on what you call cortical colon. But this structure contains a huge number of neurons, which means that from the modeling point of view, it's quite natural to address them in terms of fields. And this is what people are doing. Neural field, mean field, neural mass. And in this structure, essentially, you see that what you measure here is the results of these thousands of neurons plus synapse, because synapse are playing an important role in what we measure. And so the role of one neuron, one specific neuron of one specific synapse, you don't care. So it's really natural to deal with population dynamics, to process some kind of averaging of a population to have information about this complex dynamics. In the retina, so here is a summary of what I have just said. In the retina, this is exactly the opposite in some sense. In the retina, because you have this small circuit and you have analogic computing, you have no spike at the G cells, and the individual neurons and synapses are very important, because as I told you, each local information is processed by a few photoreceptors, transmit to a few bipolar cells and to a few ganglion cells. So of course, you have millions of photoreceptors in the retina, but the local information is processed by very small circuits, which are involving a few cells and synapses, I mean, compared to the cortical colon. And if you look, I advise you to have a look at the Tom Baden website, where on YouTube, where every week I think he invites one of the top researchers, biologists in the domain of the retina, and you can just hear absolutely amazing talk. And this is extracted from Jeffrey Diamond talks. And you see the type of circuits these guys are considering. It's completely different from cortical colon. You have a few cells, a few synapses, and they are really investigating a lot of time to understand the behavior of one synapse. Of course, you can have the same questions in the cortex. You can be interested in pyramidal neurons or spiny stellate cells, but it's a different perspective. Here, we don't have really the notion of population. I mean, small circuits matters and their synapse. So I just wanted to emphasize this point. Now, from the point of view of Pomodoro, what I am, there are different ways of considering the retina. But well, you know, in general, you use what you know the best, and well, and for me, it's more appealing to deal with the retina, the dynamical system. There are also other reasons for that. When you are very close to biophysics, what you want to understand the behavior of individual cells, it's relatively natural to write biophysical equations, which are differential equations depending on parameter. And in some sense, this is a natural way to go to dynamical system. Now, I would like to emphasize for my friend Antonio, but also Eva and others, that separation between dynamical system and stochastic process. I mean, I know that from the mathematical point of view, it's different. I know that the techniques are different. But for me, these are differential equations where sometimes, indeed, it's useful to add noise, and I'm going to show an example of that. And but for me, just a toolbox. I use that as a physicist. It just gives me key to understand the behavior of the system. So what is interesting is that the retina, in fact, is non-autonomous, which means in the jargon of dynamical systems, that the entries are non-stationary. They are changing in time, and this is really a problem for mathematics. So again, it's important to look at local circuits, and I'm going to come to that. And so this local circuit extract some visual information, local visual information, and now there is the tiling of the retina. So in fact, these circuits are reproduced everywhere in the retina so that you can span the whole visual scene. And in general, you can have very complex dynamics, and I'm going to present one example. And last but not the least, it's why is it important also to have access to parameters in the equation and to be able to see what happens when you change them, in particular bifurcation. This is because it can be related to change in physiology. I'm going to show one example which is related to development when the retina is under development, but also it can be pharmacology or pathologies, and the degradation of the retina is an important topic nowadays. So because I'm speaking about this blind people and degradation of vision, I just want one slide to deal with the team I am heading, the BioVision Lab. So, well, we are interested in understanding the normal visual system in normal condition, especially to make model of its behavior, but also to be able to present complex visual scene, in particular in 3D environment, which we can generate very complex environment. And but we are also interested in low vision, and in particular, we want to understand what happens during certain pathologies like DMLA, age macular degeneration, and with the idea of helping people to read, especially to have strategy for diagnostic and also for helping them reading. And voilà, this is a summary of my this team. Now we'd like to start to the first topic of first example. So now it's going to be a bit more mathematical. I would like to deal with the first example, which is the example of retinal waves. So it has been done in collaboration with all these persons, Lionel Jean for Infini, Olivier Mar and Serge Picot, which are at the Institute de la Vision. But mainly it was the thesis of Dora Carbonari, who did his PhD with me during these years. And we were also greatly helped by Mathias Senig and Evelyn Sarnagor. So again, I have told you what is the structure of the adult retina. But in fact, it's not like this in the beginning, where after birth or just before birth, in fact, the retina has not this structure. You receive essentially no light. Well, and actually, the retina is not prepared to process it. And while the structure is very different. And in particular, it's now that the structure of the retina will be generated by events which will last a few days, which are called retinal waves. So these are spontaneous events, and they disappear a short after birth when vision is functional, and they never reappear. So I hope I will be able to show you this retinal wave. So here is an example. So this has been recorded by Evelyn Sarnagor in her lab. So this is a piece of the retina where you can record the voltage with multi-electrode array. Here there are 4,000 electrodes, so they are big multi-electrode array, and you see this retinal wave going through the retina. So what is there used? In fact, we know that this, there are different types of retinal waves, and they are corresponding to different stages in the evolution of the our visual system. So the stage one corresponds to the formation of retinal circuits, and it is essentially due to electric synapse gap junctions. Stage two is involved in the retinotopic mapping, namely the correspondence between the retina and the visual cortex. There is a one-to-one correspondence, and involves nicotinic acetylcholine receptor. I'm going to come back to that. And the last stage is stage three, which is also related to binocular vision. And at the end of this stage, the wave disappears and they end forever. Now, this is very interesting to note that this retinal wave, in fact, have a lot of variability. First, between species, if you record, for example, the period of the wave or the interspike interval, or depending on species, you will observe a very large variability. There are also variability during development. For example, this team, which is very strong in the field, has shown that during the age evolution of it's for mice, there is an evolution in the peak of acetylcholine current, and it has an impact on stage two retinal waves. They are also sensitive to pharmacology, as you can imagine, because if you just plug a bit of chemical product to block such or such things, you would change the waves. And the last variability is this spatial variability that we can see on the movie, where you see that you have a complex spatiotemporal phenomenon. Now, the question we addressed in this work was to understand the source of this variability. And is there a unique global mechanism to explain them? So I want to briefly describe how these waves are working. So I'm focusing on stage two, which are mediated by acetylcholine, and which involve amacrine cells, actually, and a specific type of amacrine cells, which are called starburst amacrine cells because of their shape, which looks like the burst of a star. So what biologists have shown is that these retinal waves require three components. The first one is a spontaneous bursting that you can see here. At some point, an isolated starburst amacrine cell will burst and then stop and burst again and stop, etc. There is a second component that you can see here. There are very long phases of hyperpolarization. And these phases are very important. And there is a third mechanism, which is that these cells are coupled together. So in normal conditions, they synchronize. But if you use the type of cocktails that biologists are very know very well how to do, if you block acetylcholine, then you block the transmission between cells, and you will block this synchrony. So this means that cells communicate together via acetylcholine, and this is very important for waves. So many models were proposed about retinal waves, but I think the one we proposed is a step further, because it encompasses the three regimes, the three components I was talking about, and we were able to make a bifurcation analysis of this. So this has been published in this paper. So I briefly describe the model. Of course, I don't want to enter too much the maths, but basically, here you see the first component of the model explaining bursting. And in this case, bursting is due to, and it's come from experiment, it's due to fast potassium channel and to calcium. There is no sodium here involved. And actually, it was shown by experimentalists that if you block calcium, you still have this bursting. So here we use a Maurice Lecarre model, but with a fast potassium. So this means that the characteristic time here is very small, of a few dozen of milliseconds. There is one term which explains the hyperpolarization. This is an hyperpolarization current, which actually is a potassium current. And the last term, it's the coupling between acetylcholine, via acetylcholine, the coupling between cells that I'm going to present. So about this slow after hyperpolarization current, again, biology is quite helpful because we know how it is produced. It is due to a calcium-gated potassium channels. This means that upon the arrival of calcium, you open potassium channels, and this will generate hyperpolarizing current. So in fact, if you enter into the phenomenology, you realize that to open the channels, you need four terminals. So here you get R to the four, where R is the probability to fix a molecule of calmodulin, in fact, and you need four of them to open the channel. So here is the mechanism. So you have calcium, which will fix onto saturated calmodulin, and this calmodulin will go to a terminal and will open to a subunit and to bond to the subunit. And in order to open the channel, you need that the four subunits are bound. Well, I'm going very fast, but this is summarized in this equation. Maybe you don't need to understand the detail. I think it's better to understand the phenomenology. And to finish with the presentation of this model, we have also synaptic interactions. These starburst and macrophage cells are making a regular lattice that we model like this. And we know that the transmission is mediated by acetylcholine with nicotinic receptors, which explain here the shape of the conductance of this channel, where A is the concentration of acetylcholine, and you need two molecules to bond on the channel to open it. That's why you have the A2. And that's all. So we have a model which in principle is able to capture all the components we need to generate this retinal wave. So it's a very complex model. And in fact, there are n neurons because we are considering a network, 6n equation, 20 parameters per neurons. So it looks a bit tricky. Actually, we are lucky because we have time scale separation. We have fast, medium, and slow scales, which will allow us to use what mathematicians call a multi-scale slow-fast analysis. So I want to explain now in some words what is the mechanism of bursting. In fact, this is the mechanics that we got from the model, but I'm going to explain it first in a phenomenological way, and later I will do the math. So basically, the idea is the following. When a cell is bursting, a sac is bursting, its voltage increases. The increase of voltage will open calcium channels, which means that calcium will enter into the cell. And because calcium enters into the cell, you will have production of saturated calmodulin, which will bond onto terminal of SAHP. So at some point, after a long time scale, you will open these potassium channels, and so you will get an hyperpolarization current, which is due to this process, calcium buffering and then opening of channels. But if you have this potassium current, you will get an hyperpolarization of the cell, which means that your voltage is going to decrease. And if the voltage is decreasing, what you observe, and this is what I'm going to explain now, is that when voltage decreases enough, bursting stops. So now the cell is in this state. When it is hyperpolarized, it does not burst anymore. Now, because it is in a low voltage state, calcium does not enter anymore, which means that at some point, this channel, potassium channel, will close, which means that you will lose this slow after polarization current, and you are returning back to the initial condition where you are bursting again. So this is the process biophysically explained. Now you can explain it using bifurcation theory. This is what I'm going to explain in a few words. So just to show you that the model is able to reproduce what was observed in experiment, I don't comment anymore. But so basically, here all things are boiled down as this diagram. If you consider that the influence of here, the term coming from SAHP and also from acetylcholine is a slow current. You can make a bifurcation diagram with only one parameter. And what you observe in the regime of parameters where we are, we have in fact three types of bifurcation. Here, off bifurcation corresponding to the fast oscillation we have in bursting. Here, saddle knot bifurcation. And here, homoclinic bifurcation where in fact basically oscillation will stop. So when you are here, you have oscillation. When you are here, you have, I'm going to show it in more detail. You have coexistence of oscillation and a fixed point. And when you are going in here, so oscillations disappear. This is the same diagram, but with a zoom on this region. So again, here you have fast oscillation. Here you have only this rest state. And here you have coexistence of the two regimes. So you have a fixed point and oscillation. Another interesting thing is that when the cell is in the rest state like that, if you have a bit of noise, and Antonio will be happy, you need noise. If you have a bit of noise, you will enter into this region. So you will start to burst. But if you burst, as I say, you will produce calcium. If you produce calcium, you will produce an SAHP, a slow apteric polarization current, which means that you are now experiencing a negative current. So you are going this way. But at some point, you will cross the homoclinic bifurcation where disappear the oscillation. And you fall on the fixed point regime. And then you have a long process of hyperpolarization, which essentially does that until you return to rest. And then again, think of noise, you can burst again. So this is exactly what we have here. Here you burst, you produce calcium and after polarization, so you move in this direction. At some point, you have a bifurcation, so you stop this bursting. You go here, you have this long process where your current will increase and then decrease, and you return here. And now, again, noise can make you burst, and you have this stochastic-like behavior. Okay. So this is very interesting because with this model, we can explain the variability I was dealing about. So first, we can explain some observations made with pharmacology. I don't comment them, but we were able to reproduce them. So these are experiments, and this is what the model does. Well, but now I would like to go further and to explain the waves themselves, because for the moment, I have just explained what happens at the level of one cell. So I have told you that when cells are coupled, they tend to synchronize and to generate wave, which disappear when you have an antagonist cocktail. So this is this term that I'm going to study now. So I explained already that it was due to this acetylcholine receptor. Now, what is interesting is that, of course, well, you can play with these parameters. This is the maximal conductance of the channel. And this is, well, when you are a modeler, you can just say, okay, what happens if I am increasing this parameter? Well, here is a view of a retinal wave in one dimension. So here you have the cell index and here you have the time. So here you have one cell which is bursting, and this trace that you see is after hyperpolarization. And so you have these cells are starting to burst spontaneously because of noise, but essentially nothing happened, just this hyperpolarization, because the coupling is not large enough. Now, if you start to couple, to increase the coupling, GA, you see that this cell which is bursting can transmit its excitation to the other. What is happening? This cell is producing acetylcholine. This acetylcholine will excite the neighboring cells, and when they are excited enough, they start to burst, etc. I'm going to explain that in more detail in 1 minute. So you have this nice landscape when you increase the G-acetylcholine. And if you increase it more and more, you see, so this is again a one-dimensional picture, you observe some landscape which is quite disordered. And it's also interesting to see that when you have a wave here, it will leave a trace of hyperpolarization, so that if this wave is starting here, it will be blocked here because the neurons here are hyperpolarized and they cannot be excited. So this means that you have a very interesting process where you generate, by the mere dynamics, walls of hyperpolarization where the wave cannot propagate until this hyperpolarization zone disappears, which is the case here. And again, here you can have propagation. So this is a very interesting random landscape in one and two dimensions. So here is what happens when acetylcholine is too large, and you have get a propagation over the whole lattice. So I just want to make to comment briefly that we can analyze all of that, but I want to insist on that because I forgot to say it, but I will come with questions to mathematicians, and here the first question is coming. So this is a bifurcation diagram which essentially can explain the whole process, hyperpolarization and propagation of wave. For that, we have to consider two conductance. One conductance which is due to the SAHP, and one conductance which is due to acetylcholine. And we obtain for the model this type of bifurcation diagram. So in region A, well, essentially you have one fixed point, and here you have an unstable focus. Well, for specialists, here this is an unstable manifold of this saddle, and here this is a stable manifold. It's important when you want to understand bifurcation, but you don't need to understand everything to understand what I'm going to talk about. So in region B, you just have one fixed point. in region C, here you have one limit cycle, which means here that you have fast oscillation. But the most interesting region is region D that you don't see, because it's very small, very tiny, but nevertheless, it's the most important region. Because in this region, you have bistability. You have a fixed point which is coexisting with a limit cycle. And we have seen that before, which means that when you are in this region, if you are in a stable fixed point, noise can lead you there. And then you start to burst and you generate the process I was talking about before. Now, what happens in terms of retinal waves? If a cell enter into this regime, it will produce acetylcholine, which eventually will excite its neighbors. And this cell will have, it will start to experiment calcium entrance, SHP current, which will lead in this region. Here, what we see is the amplitude of oscillation. Sorry, I forgot to say it. So here you have strong oscillation, and here you have just fixed point. So when you go from here to here, at some point, oscillation stop, you stay there, and then you return back. And now the question is, where are you returning back? If you return in region D, something very interesting happens, because in this region, and I'm going to show you this region in more detail, when you are in this region, you have a probability to jump from here to here. And this is what interests us. So this is a numerical computation. Here it's a 3D view. So you see that in this tiny region, there is a sharp transition of this probability of transition. And in fact, this probability controls everything, because it is the one which will essentially control the phenomenon I was speaking about before. You see, depending on when you are in this parameter region, you can have a probability which is more important to excite the next cell. And this is where you have this complex pattern of waves. So essentially, it depends where you are in this region and on this probability that I would like to be able to compute. So I come with my first question to mathematician. I am sure that maybe Antonio or Eva knows how to do that. I would like to compute in this dynamical system the probability to jump from here to here. I'm sure that you can do that with Fredlin and Wenzel stuff. I did that with a classical Arrhenius argument, but I think it does not make it. So maybe it could be helpful. Why? Because in this region, essentially, basically, when your parameters are such that the cell return back in this region, you get a very wide variety of wave patterns. And I don't know if Ozam Kinoshi is there, but this is the type of thing that could interest him, because we get a power law essentially. So we have a very interesting regime where we know that the numerically that the retinal waves are power law. And this is also something that it is measured experimentally. But I think we have here something that we could study mathematically if some people in your lab are interested. So this is I'm going very slow, but this is the first topic I wanted to deal with, this model of retinal wave, where you see that the competition of different mechanisms can generate very, very important variety of mechanisms. And actually, with the model, we are able to explain all this variability observed in experiment. I would like to deal with two other topics. Tell me if I am too long. The second one I would like to deal with is retinal anticipation. It was done with all these collaborators, and it was the subject of thesis of Selma Swigel, who did his PhD, her PhD with me in this time. So this is again a view of the visual flow, and okay, you can again think of encoding and decoding, but there is a problem in fact. So I just mentioned some things that I told you already. Actually, I didn't say it, but the retina is quite smarter than a camera. In particular, it is able to detect approaching motion, differential motion, to detect surprise, but it's also able to perform anticipation. And this is what I would like to tell now. If you look at this diagram, you have a transmission from here to here, the problem is that it, from the mechanism for phototransduction to the arrival of spikes in the cortex, you have about 100 milliseconds, which is too slow. With that, you cannot avoid a car which is going very fast, or you cannot even play tennis. So in fact, it's known that in the brain, there are anticipation mechanisms. When there is a trajectory, the cortical activity is in advance over the trajectory, with respect to the trajectory. These are experiments which has been done in the lab of Frédéric Chaban. So you have a moving bar and the people are recording in a macaque, they are recording the cortical activity. And the different lines correspond to situations where the bar starts from further. So here it starts close and here it starts further and further. And what you see is a wave of activity, cortical activity. What you can show is that this wave activity is in advance over the bar. So this is a mechanism of anticipation. There is a wave of activity which precedes the bar. But actually, it has been also shown that anticipation exists in the retina as well. When you flash a bar in a salamander on a rabbit, you get a response which is a little bit after the flash. But you have, if you have a moving bar like here, you get a response which is before the moving bar. So again, the retina responds before the bar enters the receptive field. And this is something that people wanted to understand. So in the thesis of Selma, we wanted in fact to make a full model, retina plus cortex, and this is what we did. So we made a model of the retina first, so inspired from the structure of the retina, which is summarized here. Basically, this is a set of differential equations which take into account first the fact that computing is analogic, no spike here, and that the cells are connected with these couplings that we can biologically justify. So here we have the input, so the image. This is convolved with some kernel, which corresponds to the receptive field. Here we have a mechanism which is called gain control, which is fundamental in retinal anticipation. Which explain in particular this effect. And we have also connection between cell excitation inhibition as you expect in the retina. Now, the nice thing is that because we are a system with analogic computing, we can make a linear analysis and some kind of bifurcation analysis of the system. And in fact, you can show that it's a piecewise linear system, in fact. And in any piece, you can make the analysis, the spectral analysis, and show that the spectrum of this matrix is controlled by the spectrum of these matrices. And if you are in the case where these two matrices commute, we can compute explicitly the spectrum of that guy. So you know everything of the linear system. So we did that for regular tiling with a Laplace nearest neighbors coupling. So here you can compute everything. And this is interesting because we were able to show with Selma that we get a nice mechanism of anticipation. So this is the trajectory of a moving point. This is a mechanism which was proposed by people like Michael Berry based on isolated cells with gain control. So you see that the activity is a bit in advance over the point. But you can also show that the amacrine connectivity, so this lateral connectivity due to amacrine cells, generate a wave which favors anticipation. The anticipation due to amacrine connectivity is a little bit better than the anticipation that you have with gain control. So this means that lateral connectivity could play a role here also for anticipation. So I'm going a bit further. I would like to ask my second question to mathematicians. So in fact, if you want to make a more realistic model, you can be inspired by this structure and try to make a random matrix model. So you define the probability of connection between the cells, which I don't have the time to detail, but basically you have branches that you draw at random with a certain length, which is random, and each time two branches are intersecting, you say that there is a synapse. So it's a random connectivity model, where connectivity is asymmetric, in contrast to the Laplacian case. And this is very interesting because if you are also assuming that matrix AB and WAB and WBA connecting amacrine to bipolar and bipolar to amacrine are commuting, you can compute the spectrum, etc. So this is the spectrum of the connectivity matrix of this matrix of generated at random. And you can also compute the spectrum of this operator, which is a dynamic operator. And this is the type of spectrum we obtain depending on parameter here. Here, this is where we get instability. Okay. Well, we get a nice spectrum. I don't know. And my second question to mathematicians and random people from random field, do you know any result about this type of random matrices? Most of the time, people are doing with GOE, GUE, Gaussian, unitary, etc. matrices, because it plays a role in quantum mechanics. Here, I'm more interested in asymmetric matrices, where you have in general complex eigenvalue and many properties which are fine for quantum mechanics just disappear. But I know that mathematicians have studied such type of matrices like Alice Guyonnet, Fan Chung, and many others. So maybe you would know about it. So just to finish about this subject, I just want to tell you that we have been able to connect our retinal model to a cortical model developed by Alain Destex and collaborator. So that now we have, I think the first time we have been able to produce a retinocortical model of anticipation that we are working on and want to publish soon, and where we can see the effect of retinal activity and cortical activity. So it's a nice model because you can tune retina or tune cortex and anticipate the effect of anticipation. Okay. So, I will make it short. The question I am interested in, it's related to the previous questions. When you have your retina structure with this lateral connectivity, the question is, what happens when you have a moving object? Because, when you flash images, it's certainly interesting. But what we have seen that when we have a moving object, we generate a wave of activity, which is not only due to the stimulus, which is also due to the connectivity between cells, which means that when you try to decode the spikes which has been emitted by the ganglion cell, you should see a trace not only of the stimulus but also a trace of this dynamical correlations. And this is something that we wanted to study with Rodrigo. So we made it in a very simple example. The math is a bit more complex, but here it's just to fix the idea. So it's a one dimensional model. So here we consider that these are ganglion cells, so spiky neurons, and we have nearest neighbor's excitation and second nearest neighbor inhibition. So this cell excites this one, is excited by it, and this one inhibits this one, which is inhibited by it. And now, of course, this cell excites this one, etc. So this pattern is reproduced everywhere. So you excite the nearest neighbor and you inhibit the second nearest neighbor. It's just a game. Now we make the model so that the spontaneous activity is, say, chaotic or asynchronous. Okay, and now we ask the question: what happens if we have now these cells are feeling a moving stimulus? So it's a moving pulse. In the model, we observe that this is very interesting. So this is time. This is the neuron index. I forgot to say it, but I think you know it. Anyway. So in spontaneous activity, everything is uniform. When the bar is moving, you see something that you can expect. I mean, first, it's when the stimulus is in the center of the cell receptive field, you get an increase of activity. But more interesting is that, of course, you will excite your neighbor, so you get a bit of spread of this excitation, and then you see this wave of inhibition which comes from this. So you get a wave of excitation and a wave of inhibition, and in fact you could even imagine that it goes further and further, but it's hard to see numerically. So you can compute the activity, the spontaneous activity. So this is the spatial activity. So here is the neuron index. This is the spatial activity of the network without stimulus. And here what you see is an artifact due to boundary effect. These cells have no neighbors, so that's why, and this one as well, that's why you see this pattern. Now, what you can do is you compute the firing rate of the cells when the stimulus is moving, and you remove the rest activity. And you get this pattern, which again, you can understand very well. When you are in the center of the receptive field, you get a peak. And some excitation in the neighborhood, and then you get inhibition, and then a second peak of excitation, because again this one is inhibited, but anyway you get a cascade of effect, inhibition, excitation, where you see these rebounds of excitation, inhibition everywhere. I didn't rehearse this part, but I think this is something that you can figure out, because the propagation of activity of influence, which extend further than just only nearest and second nearest neighbors, and this is what you see here. And in black is the stimulus. Okay, and this is the correlation. This is the firing rate for one neuron. Now it's more interesting to study also the correlation function. So you take two neurons. Well, it's completely arbitrary. I take neuron 12 and neuron 15, and I look at the correlation between time t and time t plus 2. And this is the correlation that I observed. So you see that the correlations are very complex. So this means that you get information in the fragging rate, but you get also information in the correlation, and this correlation tells you about the stimulus, but also the connectivity structure. And of course, you can repeat this game with as many correlation functions as you want. Of course, the bigger is the correlation, the number of terms, the harder it's to get it numerically. Anyway, the question we wanted to ask with Rodrigo and Ignacio was to compute explicitly the response. Namely, how do you change the firing rate or the correlation when you have a moving stimulus? And in fact, it's possible to do it. So I don't give the detail because it's just too long, and I think Rodrigo did it. So we use what I call Gibbs distribution, because I'm coming from physics, but people in ergodic theory call them G measures. So people in a stochastic process call them chain with complete connections. So basically, these are conditional probabilities. So I mean, Antonio and Eva know that very well. So it's just you are trying to compute the probability that a neuron spike given its past. So Arnaud Leny and Roberto Fernandez are not here, but because if they were here, they would complain. Strictly speaking, in a Gibbs distribution, you can also you can condition on the left and on the right, which means that in principle, in Gibbs distribution, you can also condition upon the future. So I'm just considering left interval specification. So I'm not considering what happens in the future. And Arnaud and Roberto have shown that you can have mathematical problem with that. But numerically, I don't know if there is any difference. Okay, so now using that, you make the assumption that your static system without stimulus is characterized by a stationary Gibbs distribution, which means the stationary rate for our Hawkes process, I would say. And now what you do is you compute, because in this model it's possible to do it, you compute the probability of transition in the presence of a stimulus. And then you do something which is fairly easy. You do a Taylor expansion of this probability, transition probability. And of course, the difficulty mathematically is to show that the higher order terms are not important. And this is the core of linear response theory. It's the core. It's in physics. It's in math. It's difficult to show that these higher order terms are negligible. It has been proven in the case of uniformly hyperbolic dynamical system, like by people like David Ruel, because in this case you have exponential correlation decay, and you can show that the higher order term can be neglected provided the stimulus is small enough. Otherwise, if you are not in this condition in classical dynamical system, for example, you can show in the Enon model, I did that numerically, you can show that you have a violation of linear response. So you need very important condition on exponential mixing. But if you have this exponential mixing, it's fine. Again, it's not a mathematical proof. I'm not a mathematician, but these are the main ideas. Anyway, if you do all this business, you are able to compute formally what will be the variation of a quantity, rate, correlation under the influence of a stimulus. And you obtain a classical convolution formula, the stimulus convolve with a kernel, which depends on the observable you are looking at. And which is this convolution kernel is a series of correlation functions, as you expect from Kubo theory in statistics, nonlinear or non-equilibrium statistical physics. So in the case of Rodrigo, we can compute it explicitly. To make a long story short, I prefer to show the numerical simulation because the computations are just awful. We took years to make them. But in the end, we were really happy because we were able to reproduce the results. So this is the firing rate of a new one in blue, and this is what we predict with our approximation using different type of approximation. Orange and green correspond to different approximations. So we see that we are able to nicely reproduce the effect, and we are also able to reproduce it for correlation. So this is a correlation function between these neurons, neuron KC minus 2 at time n minus 3 and neuron KC at time n. Anyways, this is the correlation. And with the orange and green, you see the trace obtained by our linear response formula. We know that when non-linearity increases, when you increase too much the stimulus amplitude, you will lose the linear response. We know that at some point it will fail. Nice theory, because it allows us to describe the response of a network to a stimulus by a convolution where you can compute explicitly the kernel. I think it's quite appealing. And now I come with my third question to mathematician. I started this idea of linear response before the thesis of Rodrigo in the paper that you quoted, Antonio, more than 10 years ago. And I have always worked in a context where spikes are discrete in time, just because I don't know how to treat continuous. For me, it's too complicated. I get lost with filtration and martingales. And I don't know how to do that. But you know, I'm sure that Eva and Antonio and many others among you know how to do that. So I think it could be interesting. Just take the Galvez-Schaubar model and make the same trick, make a Taylor expansion, and if possible, and get a linear response. I think it could be also done with the Hawkes process of Patricia and others. Well, this is just a suggestion, but if you are interested, this is something we could also discuss. Voilà, now I have finished. Thank you very much for your patience.